The mission of this work is to identify the spontaneously generated local quantum numbers in strongly interacting and disordered many-body systems that are localized. Okay, so here is a brief outline. First, I'm going to tell you what is this many-body localization. Then I will introduce you the phenomenology of localization. Then describe our approach, which is based on a very funny renormalization group to find these local quantum numbers. And then briefly touch on the structure that emerges from number three. Okay, what is this localization? So this is a localization in dynamics of isolated quantum systems. So what is the setup? We have an isolated quantum system. That means it is not attached to the bath. And here is some of the latest experiments which just appeared. This is from Emmanuel Bloch's group, but there are previous experiments from Chris Monroe, Massimo Ingusio, and Brian DeMarco groups. The systems have both interactions and disorder. This is not non-interacting systems. And the idea is that we apply a perturbation and we look at the dynamics. So in this case, the Munich group took a cloud of atoms and removed all the atoms on the right half of the cloud. And then they study the dynamics. Now, what is the conventional wisdom? Well, the conventional wisdom is that systems with interactions should be their own thermal bath, right? So if you wait for long enough, the system will reach an equilibrium. And if you look locally at the system, it will look like it's in a thermodynamic ensemble. And this is exactly what's happening in the clean system for the case of the Bloch group experiment. As time evolves, you see the atoms fill in the missing half of the system, and eventually they reach an equilibrium state where you can no longer tell that you started with all the atoms on the left side. Now, is there an alternative to this? And the answer is yes. An alternative is called many-body localization, and this is when the system fails to act as its own thermal bath, even though it has interactions, and even though it could have strong interactions. So what happens here is that the system never reaches an equilibrium state. So after the Munich group waits as long as possible in their experiment, you still see that there is a signature of this initial imbalance of the atom number on the two sides. Now, how can this possibly work? Where does this breakdown of ergodicity and thermodynamics comes from? Well, let's plot. So here is our system, and here is kind of the distribution of the density. And basically what we are saying is we wait long enough, there is a little bit of relaxation, and then all dynamics stops. How can this possibly be? Well, the key is that there are spontaneously appearing local conserved quantities, which are in a cartoon way indicated by these bubbles. Now, these conserved quantities have been by various authors called either L bits for local bits, and we will call them the local quantum numbers. And the phenomenology of this is discussed in this set of papers and many others. Now, what happens? Well, initially, we have atom density on the left side, so these L bits are in up state. These L bits are in the down state. And the two L bits in the middle are somewhere in the middle. Now, because they're actually local, information can't go from here to here. So there can't be any relaxation. The only relaxation that can happen is over the overlapping L bits. All these L bits remain forever down. All these L bits remain forever up. The quantum numbers are really local. So as a result, thermalization stops. Okay, let's discuss this kind of at a more analytic level. So what is the phenomenology of this many-body localizations and L bits and P bits? So let's focus on a particular Hamiltonian. I choose to use this Hamiltonian. It's a Heisenberg model with random Z fields. So this term describes the disorder, and this term, if you like, describes the interactions. Now, if I take this Hamiltonian and plot it in the sigma z basis, here is a plot of the Hamiltonian, the physical basis. Of course, I can diagonalize the Hamiltonian and bring it to diagonal form. So here is a plot of the Hamiltonian in eigenbasis. What happens when I do this? Well, I can write the diagonal Hamiltonian in terms of these tau operators, where tau operators are themselves combinations of the initial spin Pauli operators. And the taus are the ones that are the conserved quantities or the local quantum numbers, right? Now, what's magical is, well, of course, you can always do this, but if the system is many-body localized, these coupling constants in the diagonal Hamiltonian and also the tau operators themselves are local. So they have finite range. right? Now there is a problem. These guys are not unique, because if I have a superposition of my L bits, superposition is still a conserved quantity, so it's still an L bit. So our mission is to identify kind of the most local conserved quantities, and that way we can see this breakdown of dynamics come about. Now, what is the origin of these local quantum numbers? Well, let's start from a non-interacting theory, from the theory of Anderson localization, and move over to the interacting case, the case of many-body localization. So if you look at an Anderson insulator, what do we have? Well, we know that all single particle states are localized. So here is a cartoon of the single particle states. There are like blue states, green states, orange states, and so on. And to make a many-body wave function, what we have to do is we have to take our particles and put them into our single particle states. So for example, the blue one is occupied, the green one is empty, yellow one is occupied, and so on. Now, we turn on interaction, so we move over to many-body localization case. What happens? Well, we can no longer look at single particle Hilbert space. We have to look at the many-body Hilbert space. So I call in Batman. So here is Batman. This is a picture of the many-body Hilbert space. Now, what are these points? Well, each point here is a particular configuration of filling the Anderson orbitals. Now, states that are connected by lines correspond to hopping electron, or in this case, spin flip between neighboring pairs of Anderson orbitals. So for example, this point corresponds to all the ones on the left, zero, all the ones on the right, one, and this point corresponds to flipping this two. Now, what do many-body eigenfunctions look like? Well, here is a plot of the actual eigenfunction at strong disorder. And what you see is that although we have this big Hilbert space, the eigenfunction is actually quite localized in it. And in fact, there is some point here, some point in this Hilbert space, that corresponds to this parent Anderson configuration, right? So there is a mapping between parent Anderson state and many body states in the localized picture. And we can make this mapping kind of precise by turning on the interactions adiabatically. Now, what's the problem? Well, the number of points here is large. It's not constant. It scales with the system size. It scales slower than the rate at which the whole Hilbert space grows, but it still becomes large. And also, as interactions become stronger or disorder becomes weaker, the eigenstates grow and grow. And then it becomes much harder problem to identify the mapping between these states and these states. So we have a problem to match parent eigenstates to many-body eigenstates. Okay, so here is a graphical representation of this problem. On this plots are actual many-body eigenstates for a strongly disordered system. And the question is, how do we label them with our Anderson states? So in this case, it's easy because you see there is always a site in the Hilbert space that has highest peak, so we can just go ahead and label these guys. But you can imagine as disorder becomes weaker or interactions become stronger, this becomes an ill-defined or at least much harder problem. Okay, so how do we address this problem? And to do this, we want to introduce this concept of Wegner flow. And the Wegner flow is a type of renormalization group. Now, first, let's think about how conventional renormalization groups work. So let me plot the Hamiltonian matrix. And I will line up the rows and columns. So on the diagonal, I go from smallest energies to largest energies. Now, typically, in RG, what I do is I integrate out the high energy modes. I remove these guys over here. And I get an effective low energy theory. Now, this is OK if I just want a low energy theory. But what I do want, but that's not what I want in this case. What I want is to identify the local conserved quantities, but these can be over wide ranges of energies. So I should not be removing states from my Hilbert space. And the Wegner flow is an unconventional renormalization group that lets me do this. So instead of integrating out high energy eigenstates, what Wegner flow does is it eliminates states with big energy, it eliminates couplings with big energy differences between them. So it squeezes out the far off diagonal terms, bringing the matrix towards diagonal form by small unitary transformations. Right, so we take our Hamiltonian, we apply a small unitary transformation on it, and it makes it slightly more diagonal. And we just iterate this until it becomes completely diagonal. And moreover, what we do is we use unitary transformations that are local in nature. So it takes a Hamiltonian that's local, and if the system is localized, it brings it to a local diagonal Hamiltonian. So it's preserving the spatial structure. So if we run the procedure for long enough, our Hamiltonian becomes diagonal, it becomes exactly in the form that we said from Feminology, and the spatial structure is preserved. So it tells us what the local conserved quantities are. And there is a nice explanation of how Wegner flow works in this book by Stefan Kyrine. Now, what are the properties of this endpoint Hamiltonian? So we take class of disorder realizations, we run the Wegner flow RG, we get a bunch of these diagonal Hamiltonians, and then we ask, what are the properties of these guys? Okay, here is a plot of coupling constants as a function of range. So for each coupling constant, we can assign it a range based on how far the farthest L-bits are that contribute to this coupling constant. And what we see is that the median coupling constant as a function of range decreases exponentially. Right. This is exactly what we would expect from a localized system. And from this exponential decay, we can get out some form of localization links. Now, we see that as we tune the disorder strength, so here is the strongest disorder, here is slightly weaker, weaker, and weaker, the slope of this logarithmic decay gets smaller and smaller, so that means the localization length gets longer and longer until I eventually reach the ergodic phase up there. Now, this is kind of a very gross feature of the distribution of coupling constants. Can I get some somewhat finer feature? Well, what do we expect? Well, let's look at full distribution functions, and let's think about range as a kind of a coarse graining parameter, right? As I look at further and further ranges, I'm basically looking at the system at longer and longer length scales. And then what I want to ask is what happens to the system as I kind of zoom out and coarse grain the system. So what are the expectations? Well, if we plot on this axis the disorder strength, we expect that we have several possibilities. One possibility is as I zoom out, the disorder goes away and the system flows towards the ergodic regime, the regime where it thermalizes. Another possibility is that as I zoom out, I flow towards more and more disordered regime and I become fully localized. And of course, in between, we should hypothesize that there is a phase transition, which is an unstable fixed point of this flow that separates these two distributions. And what's important is that this thing should be scale-free. That means as I zoom out, the distribution does not change. So let's see what actually happens. So here are plots of distributions at different disorder strengths. This is for strong disorder. And we see that for strong disorder, as I go from range 5 to range 12, the distribution kind of gets broader and broader, indicating that I'm flowing towards stronger and stronger disorder. On the other hand, if I start out at weak disorder, the distribution kind of flattens out, so I'm flowing towards narrower distributions or weaker disorder. And in between, there is a regime at some particular disorder strength, which is 5 in this case, in which the distribution does not care what is the range. That means the system has become scale-free. So this is kind of a signature of criticality. Let's look at this kind of from a broader perspective. Here is a plot of all the distributions. Each distribution has been offset slightly to make this waterfall plot to make it appear nice. And they have been ordered in a way so that they go from the most flat distributions over here to the most broad kind of 1 over j distributions up there. Right, so down here we have weak disorder, and this happens for systems at weak disorder and long ranges. Up here we have long range and strong disorder, and between we have critical case. Now a summary of this data is over here. Here is a plot of the small j power law, so the slope over here, which measures how strong or weak the disorder is, as function of inverse range. So if I start out over here and I look at longer and longer ranges, I go this way, and I see that there are basically two kinds of flows. Either I flow down, which means that as I coarse grain, I flow towards weaker and weaker disorder, or I flow up, which means as I coarse grain, I flow to stronger and stronger disorder, except these two curves, the yellow and blue ones, which seem to be scale independent. Okay, so to summarize, conventional wisdom says that interacting systems are their own heat bath. This turns out to be not true. Many body localization is an alternative. Conventional wisdom breaks down because there is a spontaneous appearance of local quantum numbers. Wegner flow is a robust numerical method for finding these local quantum numbers. And they're more local as compared to other methods we have tried and other people have tried. So in particular, this bipartite matching and Jacobi rotations. There are hints of structure of the many-body localization transition. We have measured the localization lengths, and we see nice flows near the transition point. And the outlook is that this Wegner flow approach could form the foundation for an analytical theory of this localization-delocalization transition. Thank you for your attention.